we are going to talk about, because there seems to be this unbelievable movement in so-called Christianity in the church today that really speaks about this thing called hell. And now they're just saying that hell doesn't exist, you know, everybody's going to get to heaven, and I know we sang that song, but we all get to heaven, but in the true sense of that song, it's for those who trust in Christ as the Lord and Savior. So I want to preface this this message, because we're going to continue talking about eternity, what happens after death, and specifically about one of the destinations called heaven. It seems to be, if you're any kind of history buff, or just simply you showed up in school once a week, you kind of got this idea that throughout history, that there are many scholars and there are many highly educated people that talk about life, the existence of life, and where life came from, and the meaning of life, the purpose of life, and maybe where life comes from, and what happens after death. You remember the turn of the 20th century? You remember this guy named Albert Einstein? Anybody remember this guy? Some of y'all know him well. You're over there. Okay, so Albert Einstein was this huge, huge thinker, massive thinker, and he developed this thing called the theory of relativity. Coming with me there? And so his thoughts were, this highly intelligent man, Albert Einstein, he began to develop this, and his preface was this, that if he could come up with this mathematical equation to kind of formulate how we come into being, about there's this mathematical formulation that would kind of help us to understand about our life, where we came from, where we're going, what happens after death, and he struggled with this theory of relativity. And understanding this, he came up with this this idea is called the unified field theory. And the unified field theory is basically just an educated guess about there's some dominant formula that we can actually believe in, some systematic thinking that we can derive where we come from, what life is, and the meaning here. And as you well know, Albert Einstein died not knowing that. Kind of sad enough. During this time, though, in Albert Einstein's life, there was this this movement of these highly educated scientists, and they began to develop something that we are experiencing today, this theory, this quantum theory. Yep. Spell that word, but quantum theory, it's out there. What quantum theory is kind of explaining to us, it's these highly intelligent, super intelligent scientists here. From this, and what they really, a simplistic way to describe this, because I can't intellectually go there, you know, for reasons y'all well know. But anyway, my point is they bundle energy. And this bundling of energy, these forces of energy, so that they can understand, and they've been splitting these atoms, and splitting atoms of atoms, and breaking all this down, the chemicalness of this, and the explanation of where we came from, and all this is part of evolution, by the way. And so this one theory does bundles of energy, and so in dividing all these atoms, they've come up with these forces, and identified where this is coming from. And they get to this ninth force, this is kind of interesting, I think. This ninth force is kind of unexplainable, it's kind of like the mega force of all the other forces. And they can't explain this mega force, this ninth force. And it's almost like they said, well, if we can understand this ninth force, then we can understand the meaning of life, the purpose of life, and what happens after death. But they don't understand that. And they never will. If you're a Bible scholar, and if you read the Bible, we understand that the Word of God really clearly tells us who this force is that these scientists are trying to discover, right? And that force is God Himself. The creator of the universe, the ordainer and the giver of life, and the one who starts this thing and the one who's going to end this thing. Amen? Yes. He's the force. And that ninth force, these scientists, this quantum theory is kind of out there, and they're trying to pull all this in, trying to look into the darkness of the space and pull these energy in with their own atoms here. They can't discover this because they're in the wrong direction. God is in the science book, by the way. He's in the atoms. He's the creator of all things. The only way this mystery that we can understand him is through faith and understanding what the Bible says. And this is why we've gone to the Bible, to the Word of God, to clearly look at how the Bible explains this thing called life, explains this thing called death, and what happens after death. Amen? And that's what we're going to do this morning. We're going to look at a lot of scripture verses. I mean, I wore you out last Sunday. We looked at over 30 scripture verses last Sunday. Well, I had 480 this morning. I'm nervous. Bob, like last time, so we had a meal. Y'all hung around because we had a meal, but no meal today. But we're going to look at last Sunday, two Sundays ago, we began to look at what the Bible says about death. And we looked at is inevitable. I mean, it's going to happen. We also looked that God is the one that has appointed this time of death. We also looked at that Christ is the one who gives us the victory over death. And we also looked at there are two destinations, what happens after death. And then last Sunday, we began to look at the one called heaven. Okay, all right. Well, y'all are going with that. And so we called heaven, and we began to explain what is heaven and some of the things about that. We didn't get very far, but my whole purpose was just to kind of get us to start thinking about heaven, because let's be honest, as we talked about last Sunday, we don't think much about heaven, you know? We're a self-gratifying bunch of people are. Whatever affects us now, we want to know about it. We're not really worried about what's going to happen out there in the future that much. And so in this process, we talked about that we don't talk about heaven, we don't think about heaven much, until we've exhausted all of our life and all of our resources on this earth, right? And then we come to somebody who's on their deathbed and 90 years old, and then we make comments like this: well, they've lived a good life, they've lived a long life, and so it's really time for them to embrace this, right? Right? And so we have our plans, we have our directions, we want to do all these things, and we talk about heaven. If I said, hey, everyone want to go to heaven? Everybody goes, yeah, I want to go to heaven. What if I said, you want to go now? So we go, well, not now. You know, maybe later. Because we've not exhausted our resources. We've not exhausted some of the plans and some of the things that we know. And I kind of get that. Okay? Sorry. Here's my point. Obviously, we don't have a heavenly perspective on this. Because this is so contrary to the Word of God. Because the Word of God, as we look at it a little bit, so we're going to continue this thought, because I want to finish that this part of heaven, and then we're going to talk about another part of heaven. But I want to finish this because we don't have this heavenly perspective. Because the Bible clearly says that we ought to long for heaven. We ought to earnestly, daily, just wait for that time when we be in the presence of God. And every day we're thinking, man, just like one day closer. And I challenged you last week. When you wake up, what did I say? Wake up thinking, man, I'm one day closer to heaven. And we're not being kind of weird about this. We're not kind of, there's a balance there. Because I believe in balance as you go up. So, like I said, last time we looked over 30 scriptures. And so this morning we will look in here. So, here it is.
Where do you want to go?
How about that statement? If we're going to heavenly mind, we'll let it stay.
Okay, let me get there.
Change our hearts about this thing called heaven. That we would be heaven. Many of us make commitments that we want to be that. I've done that every morning. Y'all make a promise to you, but I make a promise to you, make a promise to God. But I ask you to make a commitment. I made that commitment first. Every morning I woke up. Every morning. Well, thank you. I'm closer to heaven today. Thank you for that. That's kind of strange, really. Some of y'all did 2 days. Way to go. All right, here we go. If we're going to be heavenly minded, and we're going to long for heaven, we look at scripture, just longing, groaning for heaven. To be absent from this body, to be present with the Lord. Those scriptures. If we're going to be that way, long for heaven, we must know some things about heaven to kind of pull us into play, right? Like if you're going to Italy, like some of you are in the back there that just got back from Italy for 2 months. There you go. And if you have a brochure, I bet you that as you plan that trip, you begin to get brochures of Italy. Oh, man, that's going to be good. Man, I'm going to look at that brochure. I'm going to plan this trip back. You begin to do that. Well, we're on this journey. This isn't our home, right? This is not our home. If you're a believer in Christ Jesus, this isn't your home. We're on this journey, and our destination is heaven. Amen? Amen. All right, you got to talk to me this morning, okay? We've got a long way to go here. And so we're on this journey in our destination, and as believers, we know where we're going. And we're longing for that. We're groaning, as Paul said. I groan for that. I earnestly want to be in the presence of God. I want that. I mean, you go out and do something to your life. It just means you live that way. Amen? Okay. And so, took that brochure and you said, Italy, man, we're going to go here, we're going to do this. And so the Bible's kind of like our brochure. We're headed that direction, man. And we're going to look at the Word of God to really get this perspective of where we're going and to pull us that way. So we said, man, heaven's going to be like this. And the problem is we don't have any sermons about heaven anymore. Now, when we grew up at First Baptist Finance, we heard a lot about that. Most of the sermons were turn or burn, weren't they?
Yeah.
I mean, that's what they preached back then. You got choices. Heaven or hell, get with it, get on the path. Man, that's just the word. Then we just kind of soft it as well. Maybe not. All right, over 550 times the word heaven are heavenly things is in Scripture. Do you think that's a predominant theme there? Does anybody get the idea? I think so. 550 times over that, the Bible speaks about the word heaven or heavenly things. Okay, Old Testament, Shemayim is the Hebrew word in the Old Testament. Hebrew is the language in that was written in the Old Testament, and that's the Hebrew word for heavens. And what that means is the heights. It's always, hey, check this out, it's always in a pluralistic form. So it's always plural. So it talks about the heights. And in the New Testament, Uranus is the Greek word here. That's the word we get from that planet way out there. What is it called?
Uranus.
Yeah, that planet out there. And that's talking about, you know, up there in direction. And it talks about being raised up. So you get the idea that heaven is described in the Bible. It's talking about a place that's up there and out there, right? You got that? And so throughout the word, it talks about that being the heights or being the heaven of the heavenlies. We'll look at that scripture verse in a few moments. So there you go. The Bible talks about three heavens. We're going to just kind of hit these real quick because I want to dive into something else about what's going on up in heaven right now as we're sitting right here. And maybe some of your loved ones up there, what are they doing up there? You ever thought those questions? Mm-hmm. Yeah, you need to get up with them. And so we're going to look at the three heavens. The first heaven is this. There's three heavens in the Bible. It talks about this, okay? And the first heaven is the atmospheric heaven, all right? So the atmosphere simply means this. It is the air that we breathe. It is the clouds that we see up there. It is this kind of a hydraulic type of system that God has implemented on the earth. And so it kind of covers the earth. This heaven covers the earth. And when moisture is released from the earth, it goes up to a certain point, then what does it do? It comes back down. Let me give you a scripture verse that indicates that. We read this a couple weeks ago, but we didn't read all of it because I wanted to save it for this moment. For as the heavens are higher, talking about the heavens, the first heaven, okay? I'm going to explain that why it says the first heaven here. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. Now, we talked a lot about that scripture verse there. Keep going. What's the rest of that verse? Uh-oh, we get all that. Okay, all right. I think it's the next verse. Do you know that verse? That's a good point, too. I lost it. I'm trying to say, man. Atmospheric heaven that we see. We look up there where the clouds come and the rains come, the air that we breathe. That's the first heaven. Got it?
Yeah.
All right. Second heaven. The second heaven is a little different. It's a planetary heaven. All right. Let me just read Genesis chapter 1, verse 14 through 17. Just for you. And God said, let there be light in the expanse of heavens and to be separated the day from the night. Let them for the signs and the seasons and for the days and the years. And let them. Talking about this expansion of the light. Now, what's a light called? It's called the sun, right? And so now we're above this atmospheric heaven, and now we're into the planetary heavens. This is the second heavens. So when we read this, especially in Psalms, it really talks about this, how the stars and moons are in place, and God is sovereign. And He's the one that set that there. So this is the second heaven, talking about the planetary heavens. You got that? Everybody good? First heaven, atmospheric. Second heaven is what? The planets, all that, the atmosphere, the way out there stuff, okay? The universe, the galaxies, the sun, the moon, all that. And then we get to the third heaven. That's where we're going to land this thing and drive home some points here. The third heaven is the divine heaven. And this is the heaven where God dwells. This is the heaven where the holy angels are about, the heavenly creatures are about. This is where those in Christ and those who died in faith, that's where they're spending eternity. It's a place of great noise. It's a place of great joy. It's a place of great wonder and fulfillment. And all the saints who have been redeemed are spending their time there. We have a scripture verse for you. Isaiah 63, verse 15. It says there, look down from the heavens and see. holy and beautiful habitation. The word habitation is a dwelling place, okay? Y'all know that. It's the dwelling place. And who are we talking about? We're talking about who? God. God, this is your dwelling place. This is your home, if you would. This is where God lives. This is his presence. It's established there. And where your zeal and your might and the stirring of your inner parts and your compassion are held back from me. So this is, we're talking about the existence of God. And where is that? Psalms chapter 33, verse 14. It says that from his dwelling place, talking about God, from God's dwelling place, he looks out into all the universe. And then in Psalms, Psalms 101, 102, verse 19, it says from his holy heights, remember that word heights from the Hebrew, is what? Heaven. From his holy heights, he looks and gazes upon the earth. Now let's clear something up, okay? A lot of information here, so just kind of get this. And you go back on the website and review all the stuff you want to, you know, when you want to fall asleep at night. So just read that, okay? I have no idea where I'm at going. Okay, I got this. We got to clear something up. So now, I just told you something, and I didn't see any puzzle in the faces out there, other than your normal look. And what I'm sensing here is that we kind of ask this question. So if God's up there, I thought, God was everywhere. If that's his home, what's this about? Nobody thought that in this room. Okay, maybe you did. Well, we got to look at the scripture here, because let me tell you, even the heavens can't contain God. Amen? I mean, the heavens of the heavens of the heavenlies, that third heaven, they can't contain God. Because what? God can't be contained, right? He just can't be contained. Let me show you a scripture verse here. 1 Kings chapter 8, verse 27. Check this out. But will God indeed dwell on earth? Behold, heaven. And the highest heavens. Here's the third heavens right here, heaven. And the highest heavens, okay, that third heaven, the heaven of the heavenlies. In fact, King James, if you have a King James, it says the heavens of the heavenlies. So this highest heaven, that's in Hebrew, they didn't have superlatives, they just doubled the word. You know, when we say the word holy, 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 you know what that is? That's a superlative, the most holiest. I know that's poor English, but it gets my gist apart. So the holiest of the holiest of holies. We okay?
Years ago, I love this thing. He goes,
music at Network Methodist Church. That was Texas. And this old preacher, you know, I mean, he was old, you know, probably my age now. Anyway, he was old, and he would get up there, and as he would begin to talk, he would say a prayer that lasted at least 10 to 15 minutes. And then he'd read scripture that lasted 10 to 15 minutes, and then he would preach for about 5 minutes. And now, you know how we were, you know. We grew up in a church, he went like y'all do, you know, 45 minutes, you know. Yeah, y'all witness. We do hours. We know it. Thank you, Jesus. And anyway, and so we do a lot, but you know, he just did that. So I asked him in his office one day, I said, I want to be a preacher. And why do you do this? You pray for 50 minutes, you read scripture for 50 minutes, and then you just preach for about 5 minutes. Why is that about? I wasn't brought up that way. He goes, son, I look at this way. I look out there, and I know these people haven't prayed all week. I know these people haven't read the scripture all week. You know, they don't need a sermon more than prayer and scripture verses. So we're going to look at a lot of scripture verses this morning. And we're just going to read through that and just to kind of get an idea where we're at, okay? In the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father. Where is who? Where is he at, church? He's in the heavens. Our Father's in heaven. Who's talking there? Christ himself, okay? Let's go. Jump. We're going to run through these stuff. Okay? But I say to you, do not take an oath at all given by the heavens, for it is in the throne of where? In some throne of God, some friends of God. I mean, God's on his throne. We'll talk about that a little later on. People. All right. So that you may be sons of your Father, who is where, church? Yeah, for he makes his sons arise on the evil and the good, and sins arise the just and the unjust. So Jesus is talking here. He's reiterating this thing. Where is his Father today? He's in heaven. Go ahead. Beware of practicing your righteousness for other people, and you may see them then, for then you will have a reward from your Father who is where? Okay. Pray then like this. Jesus was asked, man, how do we pray? This is what Jesus started. Here's a model prayer. You know, pray like this. Our Father, who where? Kind of get the idea of it. If you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father, who is where? Yeah. In heaven, give good things to those who ask him. Okay. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father, who is what? Okay. We'll talk about accountability. Okay. So everyone, good enough. Hang on. Is that the next one?
Yep.
There we go. Okay. So everyone who acknowledges me, and I also acknowledge him before my Father who is where? Yeah. Whoever does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother and sister. You kind of get this message from Jesus. Y'all kind of get what he's saying? I mean, just a few scripture verses here, you know, about our Father in heaven being God himself. See that you do not despise one of these little ones, for I tell you that in heaven, their angels always see the face of my Father who is where? But the angels, yeah, this goes on. So something's going on up there that they're watching out. See that you?
Oh.
Where are we at?
Well, that's the next one.
That's it?
Yeah.
So it is not the will of my Father who is in heaven that one of these little ones should perish. I desire to know that. Go on. Again, I say to you, if you are more agreed on earth about anything that they ask, it will be done for them by my Father, which is where? Amen. Yeah. All right. And then last scripture. All right. So also my Heavenly Father will do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother.
That's it.
So, you kind of get the idea of what Jesus is talking about? A lot of scripture verses there. Again, that's just one book in the New Testament, Matthew, about all these scripture verses that Jesus said. So heaven is this place that's real. And he's speaking to his disciples about this. And he's speaking to the crowd. He's reiterating this. And probably the famous and beautiful monologue of Jesus is found in John chapter 14, verses 1. But you know this. And a lot of times I read this at funerals. And people ask me to read this. And here it is, okay?
No.
John 14. I got that. In my Father's house, you know this one? First of all, he goes up, he tells the disciples, because he's been telling them, look, I'm fixing to leave, I'm going to go away. And he says, I don't want your hearts to be troubled. says, hey guys, you know, I want to tell you some good news here. Man, he knew they were going to struggle. He knew the persecution. He knew all this stuff. He says, I don't want your hearts to be troubled, and I'm about to leave you because I want to tell you something. In my Father's house, not mansions. I know we sing that song, I've got a mansion. That's a great old song, but it's really something talking about the houses. In my Father's house, it's in my Father's house, there are many rooms. And then he goes on, I'm going to prepare a place for you, that where I am, that you are. Look, isn't that a wonderful thing about the promises of God saying that he wants his fellowship, he wants us to be there, and all that. So we looked at a scripture verse two weeks ago, I think. It's Colossians chapter 3, verse 2. And it says, set your mind on the things that are what? Above. And not your mind set on those things that are what? That are around you. And so what I get from that is that we've got to have this heavenly perspective. This is not our home, church. This is not our home. This is not our home. This is not our home. If you're a believer and follower of Jesus Christ, this is not your home. That's why we're weird in this life. I'm not even going to go there with some of you. Anyway, we're just strange in this thing. That's not what we're doing. What is this about? I don't understand all this. Listen, we're travelers. We are foreigners in this place. You understand that? And this is not our home. Through Christ and through Christ alone, he has destined us to be and to go to this place that he's preparing, and that continuation is still, like we talked about last week, it's still a continuation of that. So, here's a question I have for you, all right? How many of you in this room, here's the question. How many of you that you know somebody who's died, and you know that they were a follower of Jesus? I mean, there's no doubt in your mind that they love Jesus, they follow Jesus, they have surrendered their lives to him. And to the best of their ability, they live that according. I mean, to the best of your ability. Have you got to know somebody right now that you believe because of their faith in Christ and their obedience to him? How many of you believe in their deceit that you believe that they're in heaven right now? Okay, just right here. Now look around real quick, okay? That's almost every single person. Y'all get the idea here? So most of us in this room, we kind of agree with that. There's somebody that's trusted Christ, and they're there now. And some of you are, you have loved ones up there, don't you? Yes? Yeah. You have some loved ones there, maybe you're singing there. Let me ask you a question. What are they doing?
Watching us.
So we got a charismatic answer. Get your names here. We got praising God. What?
Washing us, Hebrews says that there's a
portion. Don't read that scripture, I'm going to do it later. Okay, anyway. This is what you have when you have preachers in here, you know? I don't believe preachers in here. Okay, anybody else want to take a shot at that one, you know?
Thank God. Talks about a new heaven and a new earth.
And so, plus the limitation, go back up here, so don't, what's this about? He's going into this weird stuff. Listen to what I'm trying to say to you. I'm saying that when a person dies, he goes before the presence of God. You understand that? And to be absent with his body is to be what? There you go. And so we understand that we are in heaven. It's a wonderful place. It's way beyond our dreams, way beyond our imagination. It's a wonderful place. We'll look at some descriptions here about that. It's an unbelievable, incredible place, but it's a temporary place because that's not the ultimate place. There's going to be a new heaven and a new earth. All right. Y'all are just looking at me dumbfounded. I'm going to read this scripture. Turn over to Revelation chapter 21. Now let me tell you, next week we're going to talk about a new heaven and a new earth. But I want to kind of prime you, kind of get you, because some of y'all are just looking at me kind of strange. So I better read this before I go off. Okay. Revelation chapter 21. You there? I need to hear pages turning so I go there. Okay. Come on. It's like I'm on the screen. Yeah, I'm just going to wait. I'm going to wait for the DVD up here. It's like I'm settled. And then I saw a new heaven. Now remember, let me back up. Okay, this is John, the revelator. He's called into the third heaven. He's seen all these wonderful, wonderful things here. Okay? And we're not going to get all the Revelation stuff, of course, and Dragon and all that stuff. But here's what we're going to pick up here. And then he says this, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth, that's what? They passed away. Something's happened here. You see, we're living on this old earth. I go, old earth? I don't know what's happening. And the first earth has passed away, and the sea was no more. That's kind of an interesting thing there. The sea is gone. If we see it in the existing heaven, it talks about seas, doesn't it? Sea's a good thing, But in the new heaven, there's no seas. I don't know what that's about, but my thoughts are that you got to understand that Jewish nation and the people of that lifestyle, they were farmers. They weren't really sailors out there. They didn't really kind of work with the sea much. And so usually the sea in the Bible is talking about tribulation and sorrow and hardships and things like that. So I love the perfection of the new heaven and this new earth, that there's no more troubles, no more sorrows, no more struggles, no more pain, no more struggling. We are complete in Christ and in God in the presence of Him. That's just my thoughts there. So can I go on? Okay. And it's all holy city, New Jerusalem. We're going to talk about that. Coming down from heaven, from God. Prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. We know that the church and that Christ is the husband. And heard loud voice from the throne saying, behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. Now stop right there. Look here. This is a good biblical definition of heaven. Okay? The dwelling place of God. Okay? We just said that? It's the dwelling place of God. That is a good working definition of heaven, the dwelling place of God. We just said, because we all on this earth, even the God's presence here, we have these heavenly experiences. We get to experience some heavenliness in our lives sometimes, don't we? You know what I'm saying? Just the presence of God shows up in our life. Man, that was wonderful. That's just like being in heaven. So God in His presence can overwhelm us and show us and direct us through His Spirit about these heavenly experiences. So we can have heavenly experiences here. We're not there yet because heaven is a true physical place. So you kind of get what I'm saying? So a good working definition of the definition of heaven is it's God's dwelling place. Okay? It's God's dwelling place. All right. Let me go on. No idea where I'm at. The dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be His people. And God Himself will be with them as their God. Do you see that intimacy, that fellowship? Remember back in Genesis, and Adam, he walked with God, he just kind of talked with Him, and just this communication was there, and then sin came, and then that was the first Adam there, and all hell broke loose, literally, you know? And so we see this in this relationship, and this is the new heaven, and the new earth is going to be established in perfection, and in relationship, and in glory, and all those things. Okay, let me go. And God Himself will be with them as their God. And then verse 4, we know that scripture verse. And He will wipe away every tear from their eye, and death shall be no more, neither shall be mourning, or crying, or pain anymore. For the former things have what? They passed away. And He who is seated on the throne said, behold, I am making all things what? And He goes on to write this down. All things. Very new. The that God's presence, his dwelling place, is called the heaven that we know now. We're going to talk about that place in just a minute. And in this new heaven, a new earth, at this time, the redemption and the glory of God is just going to burst out of heaven. It's going to consume like a consuming fire on earth and consume everything and anything that is unholy is just going to be wiped out. And all this, all the pain, all the sorrow, all the misery, all the trials, all the tribulation, all the temptation, everything's going to be wiped out. And just the brilliancy of God and the radiance of it, and the purity of God, his righteousness, his glory, is just going to burst out of heaven. It's just going to consume everything. And everything that we know is earth and the first heaven and the second heaven, the third heaven is just going to encompass everything. Okay, explain that. A little deep there, not too deep. Okay. Can I explain this one? Yes, no. Y'all been in my house many times, haven't you? You too, wake up. I'm in jail. Tell me from my house here in Miami Beach, Texas. A lot, good job. Oh, they live in my house.
Yeah. You
live
in mine?
I do. I told you not to say too many things, but you just blew that. Okay. Her parents, my parents were just great friends with the same church. But anyway, we Faith, and so we see a lot of saints that are in heaven, okay? And so they're all up there, and there's a big crowd there, there's angels, there's creatures up there. And then they go, who's going to open up the seal? Who's going to open up the book? And no one said, no one's worthy enough to. Finally, who stands? Yeah, the Lamb. Capital L, if you read that in chapter, or capital L, and that's in reference to Jesus. And so Jesus opened this, and there's seven seals. He begins to break those seals and open it. People are going crazy. Yeah, man, if y'all don't like loud service, worship service, just stay here, okay? You know? This is going to be loud. Bob says, other than 30 minutes, heaven's going to be a loud place, okay? So it's going to be noisy, singing and dancing and worshiping, and it's going to be great. Some people, well, I was visiting with a guy one time, and he says, will you really think about heaven? I said, yeah, I think about heaven. Is it going to be like church? I said, and before I said it, yeah, it's going to be like church. He said, I ain't going. He goes, before church, I guess. So heaven's going to be this wonderful place. So they began to, he begins to open this, he breaks the seals, and he gets down to the fifth seal, and that's where we find verse 9, and that's where we're going to pick this up. Okay, with me?
Yes.
Okay. All right, here we go. And when he opened the fish, who's he? The Lamb. Who's the Lamb?
Jesus.
When he opened the fish, I saw under the altar the souls. What's this? John speaking. He's seeing this. I mean, it's a place. We talked about that. Something's going on in the throne room. And he's watching this. And notice who he sees here. Notice who he sees. He's been seeing angels and majestic beings. And now he sees some people. He's identified who these people are. Notice who he says, I saw under the altar the souls, these people, of those who had been slain for the word of God and for the witness they bore. And they, who's they? Those who have been slain, those martyrs, those believers, those followers of God, those who gave their life, and it cost them everything, they cried out with a loud voice, O sovereign Lord, holy and true, how long before will you judge and avenge our blood of those who dwell on earth? Verse 11. And they were each given a white robe. Yeah. Don't you love those scenes of heaven? Can you see people and they got those big baggy robes? That's not what you're going to get. You're going to get a custom fit robe. So some of y'all who are fashion considerate and conscious, you're going to have a fitted robe because Bob says he each gave them robes. So a one size fits all robe. You know? Okay. Until the number of their fellow servants and their brothers should be complete, who were killed as they themselves have been. So in other words, he said, yeah, there's going to be revenge. There is going to be judgment. There will be that judgment. But there's so many others that are going to come to this place. So that final judgment is after all believers who've been murdered or who have been murdered, who are followers of Christ, are there in heaven. And then when he opened the sixth seal, I'll let them know there was a great earthquake. Okay? So here's what I read this, and I thought, here's what they're doing in heaven. I just want to say about 4 points, and then we'll get out of here, okay? First of all, what I really see, and I want to reemphasize this, what I said a couple weeks ago about what the Bible says about that, is the first point is this, is that they were immediately relocated in heaven. There wasn't a soul sleep. It wasn't a period of time where they went into purgatory, and people kind of prayed them out of that, the purification. The Bible does not talk about purgatory, a place of a holding tank, if you would. It just says that once somebody has died and their followers, their believers, and they've yielded their heart and faith to Christ, then immediately they're in the presence of God. You remember the thief on the cross, okay? A good example, right? He looked at Jesus said with his own words, he said, today you will be with me in paradise. Not next week, not next month, not after the millennium. He said, today you will be with me. Remember that scripture verse we looked at in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 8. Remember it says? It says, Paul was saying, I want to be absent from this body so that I can be present with the Lord. And then he said, to be away from this body is to be at home with the Lord. You got it? That's the first thing I noticed here. There wasn't a holding tank. There wasn't a period of waiting. That those who had faith in God are there now. Alright? That's good news. So that tells us about our loved ones. About those we know in faith. They're amen? That's a good thing to know. Right. Number two, they don't know everything. Unlike some of you in this room, they don't know everything. Because they ask a question. Did you notice that question that they asked? How long God himself, I think I did Blake Phillip. Asking God, these are us, your believer, Father, going before the presence of God, get the picture, asking this question. God, how long is it going to be? Do y'all find that unbelievable? That, first of all, sometimes I think when we get to heaven, we're just going to know it all, right? We're just going to know. You know, the mathematical equations that you struggled with in algebra 4. I just know everything. I'm just going to flow around. I know everything. That's not the way that I see it here. They're asking, well, God, what's going on here? We don't understand. Well, how long is it going to be before you avenge our blood and judgment comes? And they ask this question, you know. And also see feelings here. You know, we think, well, we're not going to have feelings. We're just going to be neutral some. You know, that Nirvana thing that the majors teach. No. They have feelings and emotions here. They're aware of what's going on. And they, I like this. They don't know everything. Right? So, I'm going to take a side step here. This tells me, I told you last week, that we are building, we're setting stuff up. And the more we grow here, I'm going to believe that. I really strongly believe this, and I encourage you, Lord, that we're going to continue this growth in heaven. We're not going to know it all, and we're going to continue to grow. And so, man, be strong now. Read the Word of God now so that you're not this infant up there going, man, I love, you know. You have this ability to read the Word of God and understand it. I'll never forget Mr. Green got saved when he was 88 years old in Carlsbad, New Mexico. I went to his house many, many times. I had coffee on the back porch with a screen right there. And I said, Mr. Green, when are you going to give your heart? He goes, well, one of these days, you know, I just don't know this Bible stuff. I don't know either. He said, well, you're the preacher at the church. I said, I still don't know all this stuff, but I just believe in Jesus, and he's the way. Finally, Mr. Green gave his life. It took like three of us to baptize. He was like stiff as a board. Well, he's 88. I mean, he's 88, guys. And when we baptized him, he came out of the water bowl. There wasn't a dry mass. It was unbelievable. 2 months later, he died. I preached his funeral, and I said at the funeral, I said, can you imagine, Mr. Green? He's asking these questions like, you know, not a sophisticated, educated, spiritual people there. He's asking a question like, hey, Adam, do you really have a belly button? You know, and just some questions that probably all of us would like to ask, but he's just asking simple questions. Grow up now. So you continue that journey. The third thing that I notice here is that they remember their lives on earth. I mean, they knew they were murdered. Did you know that? So apparently, by this reading, I just take it literally, okay, they knew that they were murdered. So man, they had some, what we would think, a bad thought, right? If you were murdered, would you have a bad thought? Yeah, you know, if somebody murdered somebody, you'd have a bad thought. Okay? And so they have these feelings and they have these emotions. And also they realize that, you know, they remember their lives. They're like, what? Now, I got to ask this question. Okay, God's in control, right? God can do whatever he wants to, right? His ways are not my ways. His thoughts are not my ways. Higher than this heaven out here. So I just got to throw this up there. God, why would you allow us to remember our lives here? I thought heaven would be like, I forgot all this stuff. Some of the things I did, buddy, that was brilliant. Some of the things I did was brilliant. I mean, why? I have to ask this question. Why do you think? We remember. Let me tell you. Because we have to give an account of our lives. Here it is. We have this clear memory of what we did. We have a very clear memory. That's something that's really perfected up there, by the way. And so we have this clear memory of heaven, our lives here, because what? We are going to give an account before God. So in heaven, we can't do this. Hey, I'm going to tell you why. Can I give you a heads up here? In case you're going to try this? Well, I didn't know I did that. That wasn't me there. No. None of that. Why? We're going to stand before him as if we were naked without excuse. Anybody get nervous in the room besides me? Yeah, buddy. Says it here, Romans 14:12. Romans 14:12. every careless word that you've ever said, every idle word that you've ever said, every bad joke that you've ever told, every bad thing that's ever come out of your mouth, you're going to have to account to. And the crowd goes quiet. The heaven's not looking so good now, is it? Really, man, I might give a chance. You know, now, here I have to ask these questions. I mean, I'm just, as I wrote this, I'm just starting writing questions on the side. So the question that I, man, after I just said all this and told you all this, isn't that going to ruin my joy in heaven? Isn't that going to interrupt my peace in heaven? I'm going to give every accountability in my life, and I'm going to have this clear memory of what's going on, of all the good and the bad and the ugly things that have happened here. And if all this, in every idle word and careless word and all this, and I'm going to remember all this, isn't that going to rob the joy and the peace that I thought heaven was all about? Pretty good question. What do you think there? Think of it this way. We'll get to heaven. We have clear memories of earth. Good, bad, and the other. And what's this? But we're going to have a clear memory of God's grace, God's provision, God's love, God's forgiveness, God's protection, and His mercy that endures forever and ever. Do I hear that?
Yeah.
And so when I told you this, I kind of set you up this to get us thinking how we live our lives and also accountability. But let me tell you, when we get to heaven, that perfected grace and that perfected mercy that's found in Jesus Christ and Him alone, He's there. And in that presence, we are going to be overwhelmed by this. And that overwhelming means that there's going to be no more torment in heaven. Do you hear that? No more torment. Why are we not going to be talking? Because the Bible says He's going to wipe away every tear, every sorrow, every pain, everything. But we're going to have a clear memory of what we do. But when we remember that there's no torment, but we're just going to be overwhelmed by God's grace and His mercy and His forgiveness and His love and His grace. Isn't that good? I love that part. Woo! I love that. Because man, yuck. Really? So this is going to be just so late. So we have this renewed perspective, you know, a clear memory of when we watched our given account of this poor, wretched, self-seeking life, but rather the torment is coming because we're going to be filled with His grace, His mercy. Now that's not going to be the way it is in hell, by the way, too. We'll get to hell later. Not today. Probably about 3 weeks away, I don't know. But we're going to talk about hell. And that's why the Bible says the absence of grace, the absence of mercy, what? There is torment. You see that? No torment in heaven, but God's presence, His grace, His mercy, His love, His forgiveness, His presence is there. In hell, there's torment. They are being tormented. The tormentor of one. You don't want to go there. You want to come to church. You don't want to go there. All right. Let me finish this one more point, okay? Last thing. They knew some current activity on earth. When I read this, I thought, they can actually see what's going on because they knew that those who killed them, who took their life, they have not been avenged by God. So check this out. Watch this now, because this kind of gets kind of interesting, I think. Some of you have asked this question. Do you think my loved ones can see and know what's going on and all this? So notice this verse here. It really says this about that those that are in heaven right now actually know some of the current events that are going on this earth. Because they go, man, God, these are people that have murdered us. They're still living. They're still breathing. They're doing what they want to do. God, how long is it going to be? Do you see the question? This means yes. So I'm going, y'all got that? I mean, y'all got that? Four of you, really. Okay. Okay. Let me clear this up. Now listen real close. Don't be misled by this. How much do those saints in heaven know about us? I don't know. How much do they perceive what we're doing, what we're not? I don't know. I know this, though. We're not to pray to them, dead saints. We're not to worship them. We're not to entertain them with seances, to invite a dead relative to come talk to us, maybe? We're not to do that. Y'all get that? Okay. Somewhere, they know some stuff. I'm going to tell you why they know some stuff, too. It's kind of exciting. Did y'all let me preach along? Did y'all do that? All right. So I'm just not sure what they know. I think the Lord allows them things, because he's in charge. Okay, so can we just say that? I'm not sure what they know. Give you an illustration to kind of confirm this. In Luke chapter 15, verse 7. You know, remember that Luke chapter 15 talks about the lost calling and then the lost sheep. You remember that? And then, do you remember what he says? And then when the woman found the calling and when the shepherd found the sheep. Remember what it said? It says, in the heavens rejoice when one is saved, one that was lost is found. Y'all see that? And so they know what's going on. I don't think they're sitting around watching, you know, TV going, hey, somebody, Wimberley Christian Church has got to say, I don't think that part, I think they know. I don't know the process there. But somehow they know and they rejoice, so they know what's going on there. And in Luke chapter 16, verse 25, you remember Abraham, we talked about this a couple weeks ago, Lazarus and the rich man, and Jesus tells this story, and they both die. And Lazarus is in the bosom of Abraham, he's looking down, and Lazarus cries out and says, hey, go send some word to my lost brothers because I want them to come to help with me. And remember what Abraham, who's in where? In heaven, says to them? He says, hey, your brother, I know your brothers. They're not gonna respond to this. They've had the prophets, they've had the word, they've had the teaching. They're just not going to respond to this. Even if you come back as a ghost, they're still not going to see it. So somewhere, Abraham is in heaven. Kind of has this kind of insight. What about Moses and Elijah? Remember the great transfiguration? Remember Jesus up on the mountains, you know, and Moses and Elijah come. And Moses, you can read this for yourself, just kind of highlight this thing. Moses and Elijah kind of speak to what's going on in Jesus' life, so they know what's going on. They speak to him. So you get that in? No scripture there. So you got to do it. So here's my question again. I have to ask another question. How can heaven be heaven if we have knowledge of the suffering and the pain and the sorrows on this earth? Again, how can heaven be heaven, a place of joy and peace and love and just this serenity that we think it is? How can that be a place of that if we have of sorrow and pain? We know what's going on this earth, the struggles in there. Doesn't that interrupt our joy and our peace that we got in heaven and cloud flying that we think so long we're doing up there? I mean, doesn't that just interrupt it? Okay. We'll throw this on the screen. Okay. Remember, listen, get this down. This is important. I'm almost certain. The joy and the peace of heaven is not dependent upon erased minds. Just not aware. It's not dependent on erased minds. Rather, the joy and the peace of heaven is because of redeemed mind and a renewed perspective. You kind of understand. On earth, here's what happens on earth. Everything's going good in our life. You know, we got our home, we got security, and then things, a flood comes. You know, flood comes. Everything in your home, you had in place, you had pitched on the walls, you had all this, and all of a sudden, a flood comes and your life stops. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? And many of us in this room, we begin our life, we just have it all planned out, and also we get bad news. You know, tragedy strikes and everything changes. From that moment on, we go, yeah, some of us never recuperate over this on this earth, right? We struggle with this. We go, man, I remember that time, you know, my spouse died or whatever you went through. You just mark everything by that sorrowful experience, and everything is built on that. And not everything is built on that, but just there's a change, there's an interruption in your peace, and that's just not the way it's going to be. Remember what it said the word Jesus said, don't lay your treasures on this earth, but store up your treasures in heaven where it won't rust or mold away. And then it goes on where somebody can come and steal those treasures. See, in heaven, your joy is not going to be stolen from you because of this stuff. Because why? We have a renewed mind and we have a changed heavenly aspect of what's going on here. And that's going to be the difference. here's what it says in Hebrews chapter 12, somewhere in there, 58, somewhere like that. It talks about the kingdom of heaven not being shaken, not being movable. It is stable and it is strong. Why is that? Listen, on earth we are given peace. On earth we are given joy. But in heaven, listen, in heaven, God is that. Understand? He just doesn't give that. We become that. And so in heaven, we see everything differently. I mean, when we see some of the stuff going on here, we see it as God's redemption, and we see that joy. And it's not taken away from Him, because He is that joy. He is that peace. Now, here's the question. Why would God allow us to see things on this earth? I thought when we die, we've escaped this, and we can kind of ignore what's going on down here. You know, just, that was an experience, and so I'm over with that. Why wouldn't God just say, I got this, you don't have to think about this anymore, you don't have to remember this anymore, you don't have to worry about this, you just enjoy heaven. Why would He not do that? Want to know? Here it is. Because here's, as was mentioned, those martyrs, by the way, that's not special heaven for them. The Bible does talk about those who endure more persecution on this earth, greater is their reward. It's not special heaven. They're the ones that John just identified that were talking to God. Okay, got that? Okay. Those are asking and knowing and asking this question because they're concerned. And here's the question of what they're doing. They are cheering and encouraging us to finish this journey. That's what they're doing when they're in heaven. We looked at scripture verse that you mentioned. It's Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1. Let me just kind of read that to you. Y'all read this thing? Read this thing. Therefore, since we are surrounded, and by the way, let me go back to Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11 is what? It's the heroes of faith. All those who were men and women of God who have died, and now they're where? They're in heaven today, right? And so all those people, those ones that were martyred, that we just read about, all those ones in heaven today, so they're there for a reason. And here's what he said. Therefore, what's this? Since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight that entangles us and keep staying in this place and keep staying with this. So here's what I get with it. All those that are in heaven today, all these saints, all these ones that have been martyred, all our loved ones who knew Christ as our Lord and Savior, they're in heaven today. And what they're doing is that God allows them to see some things there, like what's going on here, so they can encourage us and just give this word of exhortation to stay in the race, don't give up, don't quit. And some of you are thinking, I know what you're thinking here. You're thinking, man, they see something. I'm going to fall. When I fall flat on my face, and let me kind of illustrate this. If you had a child, and that child begins to want to walk, you know what I mean? What do they first do? They come to the coffee table, and they pull themselves up, and they're doing this, right? You know, they're kind of wallowing there. And we're going, all right. And they're looking at you, really? You know? And then they finally, they let go, and they take how many steps? One. And what happens? On their face. And what do you do as a parent? Did you get that on video? That's what we do, don't we? Well, they're great. And the kids think, wait a minute, I just fell on my face. You know, I'm trying to do what you're asking me to do. You guys are yelling and encouraging me. You're bidding on it. I'm making a fool of myself. And you guys are yelling for me? Why? Why do we as parents do that? Because we know that. We know the other side. Riding a bicycle, that's an experience. You know, I bought my grandson, the one that was taken out a while ago. We didn't pray for him, but anyway. And the one that was taken out a while ago, I bought him helmet and gloves and all these things and mouthpiece. And because he's a daredevil, I bought him all this stuff. Why? And he starts riding that bicycle. We keep encouraging. Man, I didn't have that stuff that had here. That's obvious. But anyway. And why? Because we know that bicycle. He's got freedom to ride that bike and walk. And do you hear what I'm trying to say? That's what's going on in heaven. See, they're not all Americans. They're saying, come on, stay in there. Stay in there. don't give up. Let me tell you, on the other side of the spot, it's worth it all. And that's this cloud of great witnesses. They're encouraging you. They're cheering for you. They're saying, come on and join. This is going to be, this is going to be so much. Yes, sir. The greatest football experience in high school was this. It wasn't a touchdown, it wasn't catching a pass, it wasn't tackling the quarterback. It was this. We were playing against Kermit, Texas. And Dan Pierre was a guy, he was 12 feet tall. He was a big guy. He was an All-American. And I had to play against him in the game. He killed me. He destroyed me. I came off the field, every play just beat up. You guys were cheering. I heard y'all cheering. You were the cheer captain, and then Donnie, you were a cheer leader. Okay, cheer. Smiling up pretty. So anyway, so the crowds are yelling all this, but here's what I heard. I come off the field, just beat up. I don't want to go back out there. It's over. I don't leave. I really am. I don't want to do this anymore. And then I hear my dad. Come on, bud. So, come on, bud. You got this. And I didn't hear any cheerleaders. I didn't hear anybody else yell. I heard my dad. Come on, bud. You got this. You got this. When I held my dad for the last time in the hospital, I told him something. Dave, you know Christ. I saw you. Bend your knee and confess him as your Lord and Savior. You got this. And I believe with all my heart, listen, sometimes we just gotta know just what I said, but there's a heavenly host of saints up there, and they're saying, come on, don't stop. Finish this thing. Run the race, win it well, because it's worth it all. Paul says, all these things of this earth are left undone compared to his riches. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Can I encourage y'all today? Just think about this. And just I challenge you, in the morning, just Lord, I thank you. Thank you for the heavenly host. Thank you for the Spirit of God. And remember, everything is pointing to Jesus, by the way. All the saints in heaven, they're rallying you to listen to Jesus. They're pointing to Jesus. They're not pointing to themselves. That's why we don't worship saints on this, but good people. But let me tell you, we worship Jesus because he's the author and the finisher of our faith. Amen? He's our prize. He's our prize, folks. So stay in the battle. Don't give up and think about this heavenly perspective. All right? I'm done. Let's pray again, shall we? Father, what an incredible journey it's like this. You're an amazing God who's planned all this out for us. Despite the intellectualness of scientists and theories, and trying just to fit you in a box, you explode in that thing. Your presence is here in this place. Amazing thing that is. Just a small sample of what it is to be in heaven in your house forever and ever. God, for anyone here that doesn't know you as Lord and Savior, speak to their hearts. Let them know today's the day of salvation, that they're going to turn their lives so they can have this eternal destiny called heaven. Through Christ and through Christ alone in faith, allegiance to him. Or there are many that are here in this room and just kind of lost it in this world. Our grip hold to the things of this earth is just so tight. Lord, can we loosen that up? Can we loosen that grip and grab hold to the things that are above us, the things of heaven, not the things of this earth? Forgive us when we've been so attracted to this. Lost our attraction to you. And for you. So God, we renew our lives today. We renew our hearts today. Lord, we are praying for a heavenly perspective from this moment on. We need your grace to show us how to do it, live this way. God, we thank you for the place of heaven. It's going to be exciting. For that, we are grateful. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. time we gather together to get into